Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming to our session today. So my name is Lior, and I'm a senior cloud security architect for a company called Ermetic. And over the next couple of minutes, I'm going to talk to you about how using just-in-time access as part of your CNAPP, that cloud-native application protection platform strategy, can really help boost your AWS security. So just a little bit of context for this conversation. Ermetic provides a comprehensive cloud security solution. And what this means is that we view cloud security in a unified way. We take information relevant to various layers of security relevant to your cloud environment, that is identity, network, data, computing posture, et cetera. And we process it all together and present you with relevant findings and help you prioritize where you need to put your attention. Now, this session will focus on the identity layer and specifically on one of the features that we provide. The identity is actually where we excel and differentiate as a company. We see it as a very, very important layer where almost everything becomes an API call. So we're talking about one feature as part of one layer, as part of what we do, and why it's so significant. So in order to understand that, we first need to understand there's a fundamental difference between two kinds of identities that you have in your environments. There are identities for services and identities for humans. And they are very, very different. So identities for services are consistent, right? They're predictable. Hopefully they run code that you control, that you can manage. It's either stuff that you wrote, stuff that you license, open source that you're deploying, even third parties that you work with, you should know what it is that they're supposed to do. And for that reason, it very much fits the paradigm of right-sizing the permission that it gets down to the resource and the action level, because you know exactly what it's supposed to do. Now, even if the permissions change and what is required change, that happens as part of a structured process, right? Hopefully, it's something that you control. Now, that is actually something that we do very well in our product. As I mentioned, this is very much a differentiator for us because we take logs from your environment and analyze them compared to the permissions actually granted. And we can take oversized permissions that you have today and right-size them again down to the action and resource level and create a policy that you can apply for your workloads. And again, this is a very effective thing that our clients really, really love because it helps right-size down to the exact permission all the time for all the workloads. And if something changes, you get alerted for it. And again, this is very, very effective when we're talking about workloads. Now, when it comes to humans, the paradigms are very, very different. And the reason for that is that humans, by definition, are not predictable, right? You cannot predict exactly what resource they're going to access and exactly what action they're going to need to perform. And for that reason, it's very hard to build such a right-sized, least privileged policy and, more than that, maintain it. Now, more than that, they would sometimes come to you and say, I need to elevate my permissions. I now need access to an account I didn't need access before. For example, US East 1 is down, and in order to mitigate that, I need access to this production environment, and you are sometimes not in a position to tell them no. And once they are granted those permissions, which are very powerful, it's also very hard to take them away. So what happens is they have more permissions than they actually need, which are very, very broad, very, very powerful, and they accumulate over time, and you are in a very bad position. And that is because humans are also a very, very weak link in your security chain. If you provide them, for some reason, with static access keys, which is usually a terrible mistake, they would put them in code repositories, they would send them on Slack, they would put them in public buckets, basically lose them and have someone who doesn't need access to your environment get it. They are also susceptible to social engineering. They can be phished, they can be corrupted. Someone walks up to an employee, tells them, I'm going to give you $100,000, give me access to your employer's environment, would they say no? Right? That's not a test that you want them to go through. And besides that, they run on devices that are also vulnerable. Right? So all that put together, a vulnerable link in your security chain with a lot of permissions, more than they need, accumulates over time, very powerful, that's a very toxic combination. And for that exact reason, we released a feature called just-in-time temporary elevated access to allow you to have better control of that specific aspect. So what it allows you to do is maintain something called zero standing trust. You basically have minimal or no permissions granted permanently to your sensitive environments. Users may be eligible to request access just when they need them, and they don't have permanent access to an environment. And when they actually need to perform something that has a business justification, they make a request. That request can be approved or denied. And even when it's approved, it only exists for a specific duration in time, quantified in hours. And once that time expires, the permissions are gone. So the way it actually works is, let's say you have users, and hopefully they get access to your cloud environment through an identity provider, through AWS IAM Identity Center, not through IAM users. And they can have permanent access to the least, to the less sensitive environments, let's say development accounts. And if they need access to sensitive accounts, let's say a production account, they can go request access from Ermetic. Ermetic does its magic interfacing with AWS IAM Identity Center, grant it temporary permissions for a specific duration, and when that duration expires, just in a few hours, the permissions are gone. Now, the flow in which it works is that you have a requester, the requester signs in, they go and make a request for access from Ermetic, an approver gets notified of it, they approve or reject the request. Again, Ermetic interfaces automatically with AWS IAM Identity Center, and it can also interface with third-party integrations to make the experience seamless and grant the permissions and revoke them as part of the normal day-to-day operation of your employees. So that's basically the workflow, and without further ado, let's run a demo. So in our demo, we're gonna have a developer. It's called, his first name is JIT, his last name is Requester, and they're gonna have access, permanent access to two accounts, and then they're gonna need access to a sensitive account called Production, which they're gonna get with Ermetic. So let's see that in action. So here, what we have is their AWS console. Now, what we see is they have access to two accounts, right? Testing and staging. And now we want to give them access to the production account, but again, we do not want to give them access to the actual production account. We will go to the Ermetic console. And in the Ermetic console, we will create them an eligibility. So we'll select Mr. JIT Requester. We'll choose a role. In this case, it will be an administrator. We will choose a maximum duration they can actually request access for. We will choose the person or group that is responsible for approving the request. And also, by the way, if we want to have levels of approvers, that is, let's say this is something that needs to be approved by several people before it's actually approved, that can also be supported, but it's not part of this specific demo. And we're going to create this eligibility. So now JIT Requester can request access. They don't have access, they can just request it. So they go to the Ermetic console, and they can, sorry about that. So they go to the Ermetic console, and they make a request for access. They put in the business justification. And now that request goes to the panel of the approver, and the approver can either approve or deny it. Once they do, if we'll go back to the AWS console, we'll see that, in fact, that temporary access was granted. Now, if we want to actually revoke the access prematurely because the session needs to end for some reason or we gave it by mistake, that is also something that we can do, right? Access is revoked. And once it is, access is gone. right? Now, I know what you're thinking, and you say, I don't want to give my developers another pane of glass that they need to look into. I don't want even the approver to have one more console they need to go to. I want this to be part of the normal workflow. And this is where such a solution actually differs from maybe other implementations or in-house development that you can do, because a lot of man hours were actually invested in making this seamless, as part of the normal day-to-day workflow. What we actually did was we built an integration with messaging systems, such as Slack, which we're going to see now, where requests can actually be made directly from the messaging. So let's say we have a developer, JIT requester. They're going to do in Slack, slash Ermetic, JIT, AWS. And they're going to get a console right within Slack where they can make the request for such access. Right? They're going to choose the account. They're going to choose the role that they need access to. They're going to specify the duration in hours, put in the business justification just in the same way. And Mr. JIT approver will now get a message from Slack saying, OK, Mr. JIT requester wants access to the environment. There you go. And he can approve or deny it straight from the Slack console. Now, when they do, the notification of the request being approved goes in a thread where the request was made, along with a link leading JIT requester directly to where he can log in to the account. And of course, we have the access right here. Now, one more thing that you can do, which is really, really cool with this ability, from the Ermetic console as an admin, you can go and audit all the access requests that were made in the past. You can load them up. You can see what was approved, what was rejected. And I think maybe the coolest thing is that for each request, you can actually go and see a session activity for that specific session. Right? You can see all the requests that were made. You can filter them based on action or based on service or based on even a specific resource that you're concerned about. Let's say some funny business happened and you want to investigate it. Let's say you just want to do some scrutiny. You can do it straight from here. Now, the nice thing about this is not raw CloudTrail. This is very heavily processed. This is filterable. You do not need special training in order to understand this. And you can consume it very, very lightly, right? And by that, see exactly what happened during the session. Now, here, for example, we can see that attach role policy happened twice. For a Lambda role, once with a policy called list bucket policy, and the other one for Amazon S3 full access, which is much worse. Oh, okay, sorry. So I hope by now you understand why such an approach is important, right? It dramatically limits the blast radius from compromising of identities. Right? If you can imagine a user being compromised, the difference between them having access, powerful access, to a sensitive account and not having it, then being, for example, in a position, even if they compromise the identity, being in a position where they need to request such access, having it approved, social engineer the organization, that's a much different occurrence than when they have such permanent access. Now, even operational errors can be reduced in their scope when such permissions don't exist. And it enables you to monitor specific sessions, whether something bad happened or not, right? Whether you want to look for something that happened or you actively know that something went down. So this allows for auditing, investigation. This is a very, very effective approach to make your environment much more secure. And I want to wrap up by stating, again, that this is part of a much more comprehensive approach to cloud security. Right? This is one component of many, many different abilities that we provide. And you should definitely implement in your environment to have a full comprehensive security of your AWS environments and other cloud providers. So with that, I'd like to thank you. I'm just about out of time, so if you want to have any kind of questions or conversations about this, I'd be happy to take them offline. And also, we have a lot of members from the Ermetic team here as well. So thank you very much for your attention.